So the title of my contribution, I was asked to illustrate something about this initiative that is Rete Archivi Piani Urbanistici, RAPU, the acronym. It means Urban Planning Archives Network. And in the subtitle, you can find a possible first key to introduce the possible comprehension understanding of my speech. So Urban Plans Archives as a source for research, understanding, and diffusion of urban planning knowledge. I'm going to structure my speech through five steps and the conclusion. The first one the first two are an introduction, very, very simple, what the Urban Planning Archives Network is, and the second one is what's the use of it, why it should be useful. Then I'll try to provide you, for sure, I apologize for this, but in a very, very quick way, three paths through the digital collection. It works.
Just the other one.
This is better. Okay.
Yeah.
Through three paths through the digital collection to explore the digital archive and its own potentials. And finally, a short conclusion reading about the opportunities in reading urban planning legacy. So the first point is related to what the Urban Planning Archives Network is. RAPU is a digital archive of Italian urban plans. Since the national unification, starting from Italy Union till now, or I could tell better, till the 70s of the last century, when urban planning matter, urban planning subject, was transferred from the central state to the region, to the regions, as a competence. It was transformed in a competence of the regional institutional bodies. So this initiative, the Urban Planning Archives Network, the digital archive formation, was promoted by La Triennale di Milano, that is an important Italian culture and exhibition institution that now is directed, is chaired by Stefano Boeri. And our initiative started in the early 90s of the last century. It was developed on the basis of a scientific project that involved a group of researchers, a scientific committee, made up of Politecnico di Milano with the University Institute of Architecture of Venice and the Faculty of Architecture of Florence. Between the mid-90s and the early 2000s, archival research and documentary electronic reproduction were carried out, which fueled the digital collection. And the digital collection was published online in 2006, and the general volume catalog was also published one year later in 2007, which provides, let me say, a picture of the digital archive collection at that time threshold. And so this is the web page of the archive, and this is the research mask, and this is the book, the catalog of the collection. The outcome of this archival research and surveys over more a decade is a collection made of about 3,000 documents, about 2,100 graphic documents, drawings, tables, and about 850 written documents, reports, general reports of plans, norms, normative documents, but also process documents related to the formal assessment and approval of the plans. And these documents are related to more than 700 urban plans, referring to different 300 municipalities in the 20 Italian regions, although without a homogeneous distribution of the digital collection. How was the collection composed? The research project adopted a pragmatic attitude. Archive surveys and investigations and the reproduction campaigns of documents were carried out according to the agreements and collaborations that was possible to activate with the institutions and depository bodies and subjects that were the owner, that were the holder of the original documents, and for sure according to the available funding too, because this is an expensive, a challenging and expensive initiative. Following step, what is the why and the use of the Urban Planning Archives Network? Let me say in general that urban plans are meaningful mobile cultural goods, a meaningful mobile cultural goods in which a temporary social path related to the use of space are fixed. Urban plans are the representation of the provisory agreement in our societies in the competitive and potentially conflictual ambitions of ourselves in the use of land. So the plans provide significant pictures both of the way of treating these issues, I mean of such a practice, of such a practical knowledge like urban planning is, and of provisory social agreements in shaping our settled habitats. But, as a paradox, these mobile cultural goods are typically dispersed. They are often scattered. In fact, they reside in a plurality of different archives, storage, deposits. They are difficult to consult, and their conservation is often summary. The Italian situation. Their cataloging is often episodic and fragmentary, and on the other hand, we have also to consider that indeed urban plans are an objectively complex and heterogeneous type of documentation, because they are meta documents. I mean, an urban plan is a document made up of several different documents, different size, different forms, written and drawn documents relating both to the project and to the process of formation of such a documentation. The research potential of such a virtual collection of cultural goods, as the plans are, is very wide and cannot be predefined a priori. At any rate, I would like to fix at least some opportunities, at least an open list of some potentials. The first one, let me say, is to explore planning teams and planning and urban agendas in the local context, sounding the thematic persistence and the renewal of urban agendas over time in the different places. But on the other hand, we can try also to have a general outline an overview, recognizing different seasons of urban planning practice in the evolution of our discipline, and more specifically, focusing on the sphere of planning tools and techniques, we can consider the different ways of doing the urban plan over time. And finally, for sure, this is a kind of archive as RAPU is, provide some elements for an understanding and to periodize urban planning evolution between factors of external and internal history. To go on exemplifying some potentials and possibilities of a RAPU archive, I want to go back to reconsider the ways of making of the digital archive. The RAPU archive was essentially built, was essentially made up through two different types of research. Search by location, I mean by place, by places, by specific cities, and searches by archives. The searches by place have as their object the urban plans of a city. Such a kind of search are looking for and cataloging the most exhaustive documentation locally available about the urban plans of that city, directly from the archival deposits identified in that specific city. Instead, on the other hand, we have searches by archives that investigate the collections, let me say, territorially transversal, conserved by centralizing repository subjects, who, for their own institutional role and competencies of evaluation, validation, storage, have collected over time documentation relating to the urban plans of the whole Italian country. And what I mean, the central archive of the state, the archive of the Ministry of Public Works, now Ministry of Infrastructure and Transport, but then after the 70s, the regional archives, and more in general, all those custodian subjects of this nature. So transversal centralizing archives. These searches by location, by place, and on the other hand by transversal archives complemented the incremental implementation of the virtual RAPU collection. Their results converged and were integrated into the construction of the digital archive collection. However, the results of each of these two different types of investigations can also be considered and read individually with specific and different potentials. What I mean, the search by place can support a sort of collection of urban biographies of cities through planning documents. I mean monographic views by place, which allow us to recognize the evolution of the thematic foci of urban planning of single contexts, and to grasp, by comparison with other cases, the analogies and the peculiarities, the recurrences and the significant shifts in planning practices. On the other hand, the reports related to the research by archive, due to the synoptic nature of such collections, favor scenario interpretations and generally and general periodizations, as well they are useful for tracing cross-sections relating to the different phases of the history of urban planning. In the implementation of the RAPU project, I had the opportunity to collaborate in the construction of the digital archive by practicing documentary research both by place and by archive. On the one hand, I conducted a long research on the archival repositories and deposits of the city of Bergamo, and the result, let me say, is something similar to the monographic study that is now presented in this current month about the city of Valladolid and its urban planning experience in the exhibition that we are going to visit. On the other hand, I coordinated the archival research on documentary deposits kept at the Ministry of Public Works, which produced for our digital archive the largest amount of documents for the digital archive implementation. Let me say, it formed its main core. From these two experiences, I'm going to draft the following two quick examples about the possible usefulness of a digital archive of urban planning documents for our studies. From the first one, the investigation on urban planning documents in Bergamo, I exemplify the possibility to describe the evolution of the urban planning of that city through the persistence and renewal of the themes of its agenda as a key for understanding the trajectory of urban transformation or of the aspiration for urban transformation over time of that city. From the second one, the exploration of the documentation of Ministry of Public Works, I'm showing you a cross-section focusing on and discover an unknown phase of Italian urban planning related to the reconstruction plans and our Italian experience. So, the first exploration, searches by place and themes of persistence and renewal in the local context of the city of Bergamo, and this is the cover of the monograph that came out from such a research, of documentary research, but this is one of a wider family of volumes. They are 14, and this is the representation of 12 of them of this series of monographical studies. The urban history of Bergamo is made up of persistent themes which resist and span the decades, but also of a change of phase in which the thematic focus of the urban project is significantly renewed. And what is interesting to note is that through the reading of urban planning experience of this city, these themes emerge with relative clarity in their being sometimes paradigmatic of an era, typical because shared elsewhere in a multiplicity of coeval cases common to an entire historical phase, but on the other hand, sometimes instead, they are absolutely rooted in the peculiarity of the local context. So let's pass through these different phases. The organization of the expansion of the city is a common theme everywhere of urban growth of cities in the late 19th century. But what makes it special in Bergamo is this is a plan of the last part of the 19th century, is the tripolar nature of this city. The old city on the hills, two villages, two little towns in the plain, and the void in the middle. And so the originality of the urban expansion project is that it takes the original forms of an expansive infilling to join, to weld, to sew together the historical nuclei. And this is This is another plan of this space with the new streets that are traced to urbanize the plain between the pre-existing nuclei, the new railway and station. And this is the core point. This was an old urban facility, the fair. It was the center of the commerce of Lombardy for a long time in the 18th, in the 17th century, that went dismissed, that went decommissioned and abandoned during the 19th. And this became the new obsession of the planning obsession of the city about the construction of the new city center in that place. And this is a famous plan that realized the so-called Centro Piacentiniano by Marcello Piacentini, that was the final designer of such a solution. And some images from the archive. So the construction of the new city center in the plain to substitute the old fair site in a very barycentric location of the new city under construction. And the second parallel obsession was the recovery of the old city, and this was definitely planned in the 30s of the 20th century through this plan designed by the engineer Luigi Angelini, that was described by Gustavo Giovannoni as an exemplary application of the building thinning out or pruning technique, diradamento edilizio. From the third decade of the 20th century, a new theme emerged destined to characterize the following period. The construction of this is always the plan for the old city. And this is the following phase, the construction of the modern industrial city and the overcoming of the railway. I mean, how the city could find a coherent and adequate development beyond the railway system that limited its expansion. And the post-Second World War period, therefore, marks the transition to a new phase in which, in an internal history of the urban planning of Bergamo, is we can find three main and well-known moments. The first one, this one, is the plan of 1956. The second one is the plan of 1972. And finally, the plan of 2000. This plan, the plan of 1956, is emblematic in representing the demands posed by the growing city. The goal, we can read on the first page of the general report of this plan, is to unlock the city eastward in the direction of the valleys, westward, and especially southward beyond the railway tracks. Such an expansion, residential and industrial, with this new mobility system. The key, this was the printed version, and this is the hand-drawn version available in the archive, with this detailed drawing related to the obsession to overcome the railway system. The following plan, the plan of 1972, is instead marked by the metropolitan dimension and tension, the identification of a wider planning area in the region to be explored and defined in the new territorial limits, is considered an essential operation to provide a reliable and clear picture of reference for the city plan. I'm quoting from Astengo and Dodi general report. with the themes specifically addressed by the municipal plan within the series of themes, we can select one more specifically, that is the role of the new business center, the new CBD, that is placed at the cornerstone of the whole new urban organism, sized and characterized as the driving force for the entire metropolitan area, the pivot of the whole structural system. I'm quoting from the report. These are some tables related to the metropolitan exploration of alternatives, of planning alternatives, concentrated development according to different axes or linear expansion that were condensed into possible different frameworks, and finally to go to the municipal scale with this idea of a new CBD that is symbolized with this violet bubble. And the huge legend of this plan. And finally, the 2000 plan that involved another famous planner, Bernardo Secchi, marks a further turning point with an attention that shifts to the existing city, to the habitability of places, starting from the concrete ways of building the contemporary city, that is the performance of the urban materials that make up the different systems of the city. And on the other hand, another focal point, the restructuring potential of the transformation areas that were one of the transformation areas continues to be the area around the railway station. Transformation areas ruled by so-called progetti norma, drawn visual rules to manage the urban transformation of priority areas in the city reorganization and requalification. Let me say schematic normative urban project. This one. So, okay, in this first track, this sequence of plans is almost didactic and speaks about the evolution of urban planning project and the modification of its thematic center in Italy and Europe in the second half of the 20th century. I think that you can find some linkage with the speech of Javier Moncluz yesterday afternoon in phasing our planning experience in Europe and above all in the Mediterranean area. Second exploration is searches by archive exploring an unknown phase of Italian urban planning, I mean the reconstruction plans. This is another monograph related specifically to that research. And in the archive of the Directorate General for Territorial Coordination of the Ministry of Public Works, RAPU initiative has discovered, investigated, and cataloged a hidden documentary section, unique in number and variety, relating to the post-war reconstruction plans in Italy. And this is, I'm going to show you something about this hidden season of our planning tradition. This season is poorly known and poorly investigated. In fact, despite their number, reconstruction plans were more than 400. The difficulties in finding and accessing the original documents have not favored the study of the reconstruction plans, especially when one wanted to leave the investigation of single individual case to compose a wider review. The reconstruction plans were introduced in 1945, and they were stigmatized as the emergency measure that invalidated the prompt application of the National Urban Planning Law of 1942, deferring the preparation of the general regulatory plans, piani regolatori generali, that that national law of 1942 had finally instituted. However, the drafting, the design of these simplified and emergency urban planning tools involved the same scientific, technical, and professional community. The reconstruction plans are very interesting documents because they allow us to observe the forms of the project of the city in a moment of transition during a shift. They represent an inflection point, but also an encounter and eclectic mix between different design cultures and different technical attitudes, old and new. In this experience, one can observe the comparison and or the combination of consolidated ways of a historical phase that is going to finish, together with the ways prompt by emerging problems, emerging themes, emerging cultural attitudes. Reconstruction plans provide an evocative and pregnant image of a rich of Italian town planning. In their controversial characters, they constitute a manifestation of design freedom and at the same time of uncertain cultural fluidity. Even at a rough crossing, the reconstruction plans affect the variety. Very varied products are collected under the same term, a heterogeneity that certainly depends on the different contextual situation, the different dimensions of the urban centers involved, and the variable extent of the destruction suffered, but not only. The small anthology of cases that I'm going to show you, it's a way to have an idea of this variety. I mean, it's a way to test the articulated dissonance of the reconstruction plans. And so, let's pass through, starting from this one. This is the reconstruction plan of Civitavecchia, 1945, that was designed by Luigi Piccinato. It reveals an anticipatory ambition with respect to a consequent general plan to be conceived in close and necessary relationship with this anticipation provided by the reconstruction plan. Also, the reconstruction plan of Pescara is designed by Luigi Piccinato, one of the master of Italian urban planning. But the interesting of this plan, more specifically, stays in the series of graphic tables that make up the series of documents of such a plan. And above all, the perspectives drawing, the perspective drawings are related to notable places of the reconstruction, the central area and the civic center, that reveal a prefigurative legacy in the urban space project in a dialogue with the planning practices and ways of doing of the past decades. The reconstruction plan for the new seat of the town of Cassino, theater of one of the main battles during the final part of the Second World War, is the manifesto of a new city of which the general table, together with the detailed plan and axonometry of the new urban center, reveal programmatically the modern forms pushed for the urban settlement to be re-established. Alatri's reconstruction plan was displayed at the International Urban Planning and Housing Exhibition in Paris in July 1947. The essential design of the elements that make it up highlights the internal rearrangements, this tiny mosaic of interventions, made of realignments, thinning out interventions, punctual reconstruction, according to a consolidated set of techniques from the several decades before, and the project of a new external expansion with an open modern, with open modernist forms located beyond a buffer zone of the existing city, this green crowd around the pre-existing city. The reconstruction plan of Parma has an ancient flavor. It combines the consistent regularization of the internal urban fabric here with the design of two new urban additions, this one and this one, which in the design ways and shapes recall the plans of the initial part of the century, if not earlier, in a sort of anachronism. Marzabotto's reconstruction plan, on the other hand, is striking for the accuracy of the graphic symbology in the use of the zoning technique of representation in years that were characterized by the search for a common conventional language in the design of urban plans. The reconstruction plans of Frosinone stands out for the ambitious duplication of the city, the pre-existing and bombed city, and the new duplication of the settlement, with the construction of this new land district downstream, detached from the original nucleus. That it was a proposal that will not be approved. On the other hand, we have this plan for Fidenza by Cesare Chiodi that was the first professor in planning techniques at the Politecnico di Milano in 1929, if I'm not wrong. This project appears to be more measured and was more appreciated also by the approval bodies. It works for contiguity and continuity with the existing city, reintegrating the urban settlement for the rebuilding of the destroyed parts here, and for its expansion here, according to the historical direction of development of the settlement. And finally, in this so rapid exploration, in the reconstruction plan of Borgo Sant'Antonio in Rieti, the use of perspective as a prefigurative technique describes the treatment of some nodal points in the traditional forms of the 20th century urban scene, while the perspective views of the modern reconstruction plan are projected into an airy vision of the new future, of the new future city that is longed for in its modernist shapes. And so, this was just a sample, a way to provide you a grasping idea about the variety and also about the contradictions of this so hidden period of urban planning in Italy, this season of the reconstruction plan. I'm going to conclude with another third track. One of the aspects that the series of reconstruction plans in its heterogeneity has highlighted is the variety of ways of drawing the plan. And for sure, the documentation of drawings and graphic tables of RAPU Digital Archive is undoubtedly the most catching part of it, both for the expert and for the non-expert layman people. And looking at the collection of documents preserved by RAPU Archive, if in particular we observe the technical characteristic of the plan design, we can make a great distinction between so-called iconic genre and conventional genre plans. In this distinction, iconic versus conventional, I'm quoting Patrizia Gabellini's book of 1996, Il disegno urbanistico, Drawing in Urban Planning, and this book is also a way to macro-periodize urban planning, starting from factors of its internal history, I mean from the technical ways of representation of urban plans. The iconic plans are prefigurative plans. Yesterday, Javier Monclus said, focused on the layout. They are characterized by drawings of the project that maintain a mimetic and direct relationship with reality. That is, the drawings exhibit the forms of a physical transformation, typically inserting or superimposing the cartographic representation of the project of the desired future city on the features of the existing city. Planimetric drawings are often associated with others in elevation and perspective, which give a shape for the remarkable places of the city to the new urban landscape to which plan tends. This is a kind of plan making that characterizes the entire Italian post-unification period up to the third decade of the 20th century. And this is a section from the archive through this period, through the decades. Around that inflection points, inflection point at the 30s of the last century, which is also the period marked by the revolutionary lesson of the modern movement, the urban planners' drawings are enriched with a powerful tool. Through the zoning table and the legend who will guide its reading, the invention of a special symbolic language will allow urban planning to express a range of new, potentially unlimited contents beyond the physical morphological ones. It is the debut, the beginning, of the conventional genre plans, which will dominate the Italian urban scene until all the 70s. And the 60s and the 70s will be those in which the use of conventional language in planning will be more radical, and the plan table tends to become a mere support for ruling, the plan representation as a map of the rules of the for the city. And this is a section starting from the 30s, going to the 40s, in such a kind of way of representing urban planning. Rome. And I wanted to show also this so abstract representation of the plan in 1978 for the city of Ferrari. There is also a third phase that I have to skip that is related to a mixed genre way of representation of the plan that is strictly related to the third phase that also IBM includes focus on in its intervention yesterday afternoon. But I want to go back instead to consider the switch point, the shift between iconic and conventional, because this is interesting. The threshold between iconic and conventional plans, I mean the 30s, are particularly interesting from the point of view of the plan representation, because it's very, very frequent the case in which the design of the plan, the design of planning contents, are expressed through two main and distinct elaborates. On the one hand, an iconic prefigurative general planimetry, as in this case of the early 30s for Salso Maggiore. So the red for new constructions and the yellow for demolitions, what is to be demolished. So this is a prefigurative table combined together with the zoning table. Essential morphological characters pushed from the transformation, linked together with other contents of the planning action, with the zoning technique used to convey contents related to the functional organization, the maximum building ratio, the building types allowed, and so on, and also through a series of competitions. The 30s of the last century was a meaningful period for urban planning research through planning contests, and this is the project of a group involved in the competition for the urban plan of Como in 1933. The zoning table, together with a morphological planimetry of the project that is studied in the detail till to the exploration of some relevant focal points of the city. So it's a very, very interesting threshold, the 30s. And now I'm going to conclude. In this so rapid outline, I try to provide some, let me say, clues about the interest and potential of urban planning digital archives for research. More specifically, the few examples I briefly illustrated from RAPO Archive, from RAPO Research Experience, try to provide some arguments for the opportunity and usefulness of collecting and rereading planning documents towards a more effective internal history of urban planning. Because I'm going to quote a sentence that I like a lot from Bernardo Secchi, a book, Prima Lezione di Urbanistica, because the history of urban planning certainly cannot be written only as internal history. However, it is ridiculous when it is written exclusively in terms of external history. So, the archives and the rereading of urban planning documents open up infinite possibilities and research purposes. For instance, they can fuel greater awareness in recognizing the interactions between internal and external history in urban planning. Interactions, but also mismatches. On the other hand, through the investigation of the reasons of urban planning making over time, urban plans archives serve to nourish more conscious and reflective design practices. They are useful to our contemporary planning practices. This awareness about the stratified layers of our way of doing through the time and the renewal of themes in our urban agendas. But this kind of initiatives like RAPU project above all help us to recognize the individuality and specificity of urban planning knowledge, considering its diachronic depth beyond a mute tyranny of the moment. Thank you very much.